people think I'm damaged goods.
I'm worried about losing my job.
Will I ever get a transplant?
I want to see my children graduate from college.
How can I afford this?
I don't want to be a burden.
I'm afraid.
I'm overwhelmed with information.
Sometimes I wonder if I'll ever fall in love and get married.
I just want to play with my friends.
You're listening to Kidney Talk, streaming health, happiness, and hope to the renal community with your hosts, Lori Hartwell and Stephen First.
Welcome to Kidney Talk.
I'm Lori Hartwell.
And I'm Stephen First. And you know what? We're going to talk about a topic that I just love because it's about traveling. I travel a lot for work, and I just love to travel and see all over the world and all different places.
Well, I have to tell you, I when I was on dialysis, I always dreamed I wish I could travel. And to date, I can say that I've been to over 46 states.
traveling. While on dialysis?
No, I did some when I was on dialysis, but I've been traveling for the last few years, just speaking, and I never thought that I would travel as much as I've traveled, and it's just such a wonderful experience.
You know, it's so funny because when you get diagnosed with kidney disease and they say you have to go on dialysis, you think certain things are over for you, you know, working, traveling.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't have to be true.
It doesn't. When I was on dialysis, I never had much money. So my idea of traveling
is going to help you with that.
My idea of traveling was I would go camping or I would go on short weekends. I never could afford the long trips. So I know we're going to be speaking to Bill Peckham, who's been to...
Bill Peckham is fascinating.
He's been all over the world.
He's been in so many countries and continents, and he's a dialysis patient. And we're going to really thoroughly talk to him about how he does it. How does he travel being on dialysis, especially in foreign countries? Because I think we're all spoiled by being in the United States with the utmost technology and everything. And I always think, gosh, what if I want to go to Africa? What if I want to go to, you know, Yugoslavia? You know, are they going to have the machines? Are they going to know what to do?
Right.
So he's going to, you know, set us straight. And and you know, I think there are travel people who actually specialize in booking tours and trips for dialysis patients.
Yes, there's a dialysis cruise line. There's all kinds of things.
I know. It's so funny, a dialysis cruise.
My aunt and her boyfriend just went on a dialysis cruise, and they had a fabulous time. So I think that it's...
I think you have to be a cruise person because, you know... You know what? I don't know if I'm a cruise person. I've never been on a cruise before.
I love cruises. I've been on several cruises.
But what do you do on a cruise?
Well,
I mean,
you eat.
I know, that's the whole thing. It's all built around eating.
You
and
eat,
when
you
we're
watch
on
shows,
such restrictions.
You rest, you get off. You know, the thing is about a cruise, what I like about it is you don't have to think about anything. You don't have to drive
anywhere.
Well,
I don't anywhere. Do that anyway. But,
you know, you get off the boat and you walk around and, you know, you can do
well,
as little as you want.
Well, hopefully the boat is docked
exactly.
at the time.
Exactly. This is true. That's kind of disastrous. But, yeah, I really enjoy cruises. And I think my husband and my mom and, you know, we're thinking about going on an Alaska cruise. And I think that will be a great experience. So...
Well, the other thing I know is, like I say, I've never been on a cruise, but I understand that, like, you sit down with certain people and you have to sit at that table the entire time. So what if you don't like the person you're sitting next to?
I think you can be moved.
You can be moved?
But yes.
Then you hurt the people's feelings and, you know.
It's fun. I mean, you know, the thing that I love about traveling is all the people you meet. And the different people. And that's what I think is really neat about a cruise because, you know, you're on the ship and the first day, then the second or third day, you start running into the same people, so you strike up conversations. And that's one of the things that I really like about traveling is because I really enjoy meeting people. And that's an opportunity that a cruise provides.
And one thing I love about traveling is not only meeting the people, but just submerging myself in the local culture.
Yes. Well,
obviously, in the United States, it wouldn't be that big of a difference. But, you know, I work a lot in Bulgaria. And when I first got there, it was culture shock, you know. It's like stepping back in time about 50 years. But the people are just so lovely. And I love the fact that when I work in Bulgaria, I'm not in an American-speaking hotel at all. I live in an apartment in the city, and I go shopping at the local market you know, the produce market and the, they don't have like big markets there. They have like, they have their produce market.
They don't
market.
Have the mega markets there like
no,
we do.
No, but I really, and it's very difficult because nobody speaks English there basically. But to learn how to communicate and shop and just get a taxi and everything. I mean, I am provided with an interpreter, you know, but a lot of times I'm not with her. So, It's pretty fascinating, and this is going to be fascinating to me because I love to travel, and we are going to talk to Bill Peckham, who has, he's like an expert, you know, I think he should write a book. I'm going to suggest that when we talk to him about how to, you know, travel and stuff. So when we come back, after Ricky Nelson sings his song, Traveling Man, again, we'll be back with...
Bill Peckham.
Bill Peckham, Mr. World Dialysis Traveler.
I'm a traveling man. Made a lot of stops all over the world, and in every port I owned the heart of at least one lovely girl. I've a pretty senior.
Oh, I just love pretzels. Let me see here. One serving is 6 pretzels? What, are they kidding me? Who only ate 6 pretzels? I have to stay on my renal diet. I know. I can bite part of one pretzel, then bite the side of another pretzel, and then I hook them together, and I can count that as one pretzel. Mmm. Boy, that was good. You know what I love now? A big gulp. Now, if I fill it up halfway, and then drink it, and refill it to the top... Now that won't count towards my daily fluid intake. Or will it?
Make the connection. Eating high sodium foods makes you thirsty, which will make you retain more fluids. Do you want to share a tip on how to stay within your fluid limit? Email us at kidneytalk@rsnhope.org and we'll let our listeners in on your different tips.
Oh, my sweet Fräulein down in Berlin town makes my heart start to yearn. My China doll down in old Hong Kong waits for my return. Pretty Polynesian baby.
Welcome, Bill Peckham, world traveler, kidney patient. How are you?
Great. It's great to be here.
Yes, we're excited, so excited to hear about your adventures.
Yeah, we are so excited to talk to you because I know for me, when I was diagnosed with kidney disease and having to go on dialysis, I thought, hey, that's the end of it. I'm going to have to stay at home. I'm going to have to stay within 5 miles of my dialysis unit. But you proved it all wrong.
I know. Stephen, I felt the same way when I started back in September of 1990. That was before the internet. And I really thought my travel days were over. I had loved traveling before I started dialysis, but... I really didn't understand how widely you could travel, even needing dialysis 3 days a week.
So where is the first place that you traveled?
Well, I started in September of 1990, and then that Christmas I went back to the Chicago area where my family is. And so it was really within 3 months I had taken my first trip. But what I learned was how nerve-wracking it was to go to a new unit and have someone else put in your needles and just the whole unknown.
That must have been really scary for the first time, because, I mean, I was scared to go to my own dialysis unit the first time.
Yeah, I guess I should have been journaling back then, but I can't say I really remember the experience. I just remember coming home and deciding right then that I was going to learn to put my own needles in. Because once the needles are in, we all kind of... are the same. Just
now,
hook us up to the machine.
Own needles in, even on the inpatient?
In-center, yeah. I started putting in my needles right after that trip in 1991, in this, I think February, March of 91. And I've been doing it ever since. So,
well, no, what's the reason for you putting in your own needles at in-center? I mean, is there
well, who knows my fistula better than me? And it actually, I found it hurts less because you're kind of doing it. And just the whole thing about it is a better experience. Self-care and taking charge of your care, it's all a piece of doing well on dialysis. And I think certainly for someone who likes to travel like myself, putting your own needles really is a great way to go because it takes all the... you know, that worry out of visiting another unit. Once the needles are in, they should be able to hook you up just like they do their own patients day after day. And it also kind of says to the staff, well, here's someone who really does take control of their treatment, is engaged, you know, doesn't know what they're doing. And because they don't know you either, but if you're putting in your own needles, it's kind of a statement about how involved you are in your care.
Now, do you have to get trained to do that, or you just came in one day and say, hey, guys, I'm going to do my own needles today?
Well, you talk to the most experienced person on the staff, and you imagine it. And I remember the one staff kept telling me I should learn to do it, and I kept saying no, but she didn't take no for an answer. So I'm very indebted to April, but... I've
she
seen
just
other
kept
people
encouraging
learn to do
you
it.
That you could do it. Is that how it worked? She just kept reminding you.
Yeah, she knew I could do it. She said and how much better I would think it was. You know, it's a barrier to come over. I didn't like needles. I had a needle fear. I didn't even like looking. So it's a process. And she really saw in me that I had the ability to do it. And she was right. It is much better, even though. It's always easier to do nothing, but you have to come over that and realize that once you do get engaged, it makes everything go easier.
Now, I know that you've traveled throughout the world. I'm really excited to hear about some of your travels.
Well, in 1995, I joined the Carpenters Union, and they have excellent insurance because Medicare will only reimburse their 80% for dialysis units in the United States and Puerto Rico and the Virgin Islands, by the way. But for the Carpenters Union, once they would reimburse me for anything Medicare didn't cover, so that opened up the whole world for travel. And it turns out you can travel all over the world. I went down to Costa Rica. That was my first trip abroad in 1995.
Was that
I really
scary?
Haven't looked back.
Was that scary, the first international trip?
I was excited, and it was just great. And it was, more primitive, I guess you would say, the unit, you know, like bottles of iodine instead of little individual iodine swabs, you know, that sort of thing. But still, the machine's the same. I put in my needles, and, you know, away we go. And so I have been able to take a trip every year I've gone abroad since that 1995. And now, looking back, I've gone to 5 different continents, still South America and Antarctica. And then I've seen 29 countries since starting dialysis, actually dialyzing in 19 countries.
Well, what's one of the most exciting or most memorable places that you've been?
Well, you know, I love Europe. It's great going to Australia, but, boy, Africa is just something you never – when I started dialysis, I thought for sure I just would never be able to go on a game safari, you know, a photo safari, where you're in those open jeeps and you're looking at lions that have just killed a giraffe, and that's what happened. I went to Africa. I met my mom in Cape Town, and we took a drive across the southern tip of Africa. It's called the Garden Route from Cape Town to Port Elizabeth, and I had dialysis in Cape Town and then Port Elizabeth. I mean, that was just amazing to go from the Atlantic to the Indian Ocean. You know, so exotic and different feeling. You knew you weren't in Europe.
What were the dialysis units like in Africa?
Well, they're very small. They're private units Africa, because of its unique history, has kind of a two-tier medical system, and the public system's under a great deal of stress. But there's this private system that's open to people who can self-pay, but it's actually quite a bit cheaper than, say, Europe, where treatments might be $400 to $500 a pop. South Africa, they were about, in 1999, $180. So that's within reach of people, even if they don't have insurance. And they're really pretty nice units. There's a, you know, sometimes I was the only patient. And so I had a doctor and a nurse all to myself. It was like home dialysis. And other times, you know, you're in a kind of a low amenity situation where there isn't a TV or, you know, it's kind of,
I'd be totally lost without a TV.
Well, you got to bring a book or just talk to them. I remember that was in Port Elizabeth, and, you know, just talk to the gentleman, and there were peacocks right outside the door. And then Nels Pruitt is close to the Sabi Sabi Game Reserve, which is a kind of a famous game reserve. It was an amazing experience. It was just a great, you know, something that you just, I didn't think I would ever get to do. And then on that same trip from there, I flew on to eventually Sydney and then Cairns, and I rented a room just out of the paper and spent, you know, 5 weeks in Cairns living abroad for a month, which is another thing I kind of never thought I would do. And at that in Cairns, which is right on the Great Barrier Reef. It was wonderful dialysis, kind of dialysis with a concierge service, I'd say.
Oh, wow.
It was, they'd pick you up and drop you off, order, carry out food from one of the restaurants around, and the unit was on the 12th floor with floor-to-ceiling windows, so you'd look out on the Great Barrier Reef and the ships coming and going. And incidentally, there was the back of a hotel, so you could use the unit's supplied binoculars to do a little voyeurism.
Wow, you see, you kind of felt like Jimmy Stewart in Rear Window, huh?
Yeah, that's right. It could have been solving mysteries while I dialyzed in Cairns.
Yeah, you took a lot of pictures of, you know, Africa and everything. Did you take pictures inside the dialysis unit to see the different, you know, memories of those?
Yeah, I do. I have, it's me dialyzing all over the world. I have a picture of me dialyzing on a bed that's also a scale. So there's a big, like a butcher shop scale behind me, and they can watch your weight decrease as they draw fluid. That was in Florence, Italy. And,
oh, wow.
Yeah, so it's just, you know, a little different, and you know, some units, they actually have you change into scrubs, you know, before you dialyze.
Oh, really?
Yeah. The units in Holland were like the dental chairs. They were the most comfortable chairs ever, and they moved every which way. You know how, like, a dental chair is kind of long and narrow like that? And
Yeah, and it
was really quite comfortable. The other great thing about traveling is that really, food is almost always available when you travel abroad. Either, you know, something simple like just a loaf of bread and some cheese, or a four-course meal that I had in Taps in France, where you had a steak and baked potatoes and salad, a cheese course, and then you could have beer or wine.
Potatoes, so, potatoes, cheese, beer, and wine?
I know.
Aren't you concerned about the phosphorus and potassium?
Well, Taps in France is known the world over, and I picked this unit on purpose because they've been dialyzing people for 8 hours, 3 days a week since the 70s.
Oh, they dialyze for 8 hours?
8 hours, 3 days a week, and they have tremendous outcomes, really good outcomes. And one of the things is you can eat cheeses and have a liberal diet like that. And
yeah,
so that was a real lesson that I learned when I traveled, that, hey, there's other, you know, alternatives to this four-hour, three-day-a-week model, and some of them really make you feel good. And so you know, seeing how dialysis is, try to, you know, challenge our ideas of what's possible.
Now, I understand you recently switched from in-treatment, in-center dialysis, right? To a
That's right.
Time?
In 2001, so it's been a little while now, but I switched to home high-dose dialysis. And that means, you know, dialyzing more than three times a week. And because the first hour of dialysis is the best hour, the more first hours that you get, the better you feel. So you don't have to dialyze 5 hours or 4 hours each treatment. You can go 2 or 3 hours, but more frequently, and you feel much better. And,
so how often do you dialyze?
Dialyze. Six or seven days a week. Sometimes I don't even take a day off. I might go 12 days in a row, and I dialyze 2 or 3 hours at a time, depending on when my last day off was.
And how do you feel?
I think later this month I'll start dialyzing for 8 hours on Friday and Saturday nights. And then I can just dialyze 2 hours during the work week.
And so, how do you feel as compared to in-center, you know, three times a week?
Oh, I feel great. I have energy and my diet's more liberal. It's easier dealing with the burden. I just, after work, I go home and dialyze for 2 or 3 hours, watch TV, have friends over, go on the internet. So it's a great fit for my life. And that's what I think is important, is finding the schedule and the treatment that best fits your life. And I don't think we should be bent to fit somebody's model of dialysis rather than we should bend that model of dialysis to fit us.
Right. You know, I understand there's cruises. Have you ever been on a cruise?
I did. In 1998, my mom and I went from Dover to Copenhagen via the Scandinavian capitals and St. Petersburg. And my mom, I made her spend her first and last night in a youth hostel, a St. Petersburg youth hostel.
Oh, she must have loved that.
Instead of the five-star whatever Holland America Line ship where, you know, you're dining on crystal, that we were at the youth hostel. But it was a great experience. We got to see the Hermitage and walk around St. Petersburg. It was great. And and that's right. When you're not in port, either in the morning or at night, they will dialyze you in the infirmary of the ship. like a subcontractor, Dialysis C, it's a separate company, sets up treatment, and that's just organize it through them. There's a couple companies that organize cruises for people on dialysis.
Now, do you like cruises or do you not like them?
You know, I just kind of found that out. I really wanted to love it, but it's, you know, I just would rather be on land. And so if I was going to Alaska or Antarctica, then I would go on a cruise because there's no other way. But for me, in the Caribbean or Europe, I like being on land. And it's kind of just, you know, some people love cruises, other people, I'm one of the next category.
I've never been on a cruise, and I never thought I would like it because I know a lot of it's built around eating, and I try to watch my diet. And the other thing is, I understand when you're dining, you're assigned to a table, and you have to sit with the same people the entire time, and, you know, what if you don't
right.
like that person?
You know that scene in Animal House where they go to pledge, and you know, they meet all the cool kids, and then they end up in the corner at the couch?
I'm not familiar with that movie.
Oh, you should see it. That is a wonderful movie.
Oh, great. I'll have to catch that.
Yeah. But it's just a cruise experience and maybe a honeymoon experience or something with a couple. I mean, it's a couple thing. And it's expensive. I mean, all said and done, it is more expensive than a land cruise. You know, the way I travel, setting it up myself and staying at sort of bed and breakfast style.
Mm-hmm. Or youth hostels.
I've stayed in youth hostels. I've slept on the floor of train stations, you know. So I'm getting older. I'm less likely to do that now. I'm kind of more of the bed and breakfast.
You can write the book on, you know, Europe on $10 a day.
Yeah, maybe a 50. I tried. Back when the exchange rate was better.
So I bet you meet some very interesting people.
Maybe. Yeah, I mean, you know, I've tried to, and I meet people online, too, because there's kind of the community of people that love to travel and who are on dialysis, and there's I'm a moderator on the dialysis.com or globaldialysis.com website.
Oh,
and as the name implies, globaldialysis.com, where 127 units are listed in their database as offering dialysis around the world, or 127 countries having dialysis facilities available for travelers.
And it's called globaldialysis.com.
Yep, and so there's message boards there, and I've put a blog up with descriptions of past trips and emails I've written, and so there's a whole group of people who love to travel. And I say that I have a wanderlust comorbidity. You know, comorbidity is something I have in addition to renal failure, and my comorbidity is wanderlust, and so
you're
it's kind of expensive.
You're using awfully big words.
Just means I love to travel, and I have a need to travel. Really nothing like it.
I bet you met some fascinating people when you traveled, but people you probably wouldn't normally meet if you were on a typical trip.
Well, yeah, I mean,
all over units.
In the units, just like I'm in Belgium and get to talking to the guy at the unit, and then it turns out, you know, he's on the editorial advisory board of Nephrology News and Issues, the European, and we start knowing people in common and how long they've been in the business. There's a lot of people over there, you know, that started in dialysis in the 70s when it first kind of came to Europe and have been in it a long time, and they're open to new ideas. And you know, and a lot of times I'll meet up with people that I've met online, so like Lise in Holland, and we'd go there and be able to meet her in person and in meet space instead of cyberspace. And it's also, you know, done things where, like when I was in Cannes, I rented a room, and it was from, you know, people who were kind of into the techno dance scene. That's, you know, a group I hadn't met before. So, you know, by getting out, you definitely get to meet all kinds, that's for sure.
Now, when you're traveling in a faraway country like Australia, is there anything you have to do on the airlines with such a long trip? Any tips or things that we have to remember as kidney patients?
Well, maybe even more so because we can just stay in our seats. I don't often have to get up, you know, have to get up to go to the bathroom. So sometimes it can be nice when you're flying. And
so you can get a window seat and not annoy the other people.
Just have a window seat and call it good. So I'm aware that you should make sure you stretch and not just sit in one position the whole time. So I try to kind of do that at the seat where you can you know, press your feet against things and squirm around, I guess, more than anything. But no, I think it's, you know, you have to keep that in mind. And I remember on that around the world trip, I counted them down. I had 28 flights in all. So,
your frequent flyer miles. You must have a ton of
them. Yeah, I have a way of using those right back up. So yeah.
Well,
as soon as I get any amount of them.
I have a question, Bill. I mean, and this is probably something that are on the minds of many people out there. You know, have you gotten sick when you've traveled, or what precautions do you take? I mean, that's always
Well, I always tell myself that, you know, home is a day away, you know, right? In this day and age, you can get on a flight and be back from just about anywhere in the world. So that's kind of what I keep in mind going forth. But no, I've never had to board a trip and come home. I've had a cold while traveling, and let me tell you, when you're in Paris with a cold, people just aren't sympathetic. But it's no fun, you know, when you just don't really feel well and you're out traveling. But as far as like renal related or dialysis related, no, I really haven't. I was mugged in Costa Rica on that trip, but for me, that was like part of the travel adventure. You know, I was like, oh yes, I got mugged in Costa Rica. I thought that would never happen to me.
But that had nothing to do with kidney disease, correct?
That had nothing to do with kidney disease. But,
where are you planning to go next? I mean, I'm excited to hear the adventure.
Well, I have a lifetime goal of seeing 50 countries, and my lifetime list right now is at 31.
Well,
that list just got shorter because I looked online what counts as a country, and apparently can't count things like Bermuda and the Cayman Islands because they're associated with Britain or the Netherlands. So I went from 38 to 31 after looking online at the definition of a country. But I think I can get to 50. I want to go to South America next. I'd love to go to Machu Picchu this year.
Could you say that again, please, slowly?
Machu Picchu, which is Inca ruins in Peru. And you fly into Lima and then go to Cusco, so both places have dialysis, and then from there I'd have to use my weekend to go visit the actual Inca ruins.
Wow.
And it just is something that would really appeal to me. And another place in South America I'd love to go is Iguazu Falls, which is right on the Brazil-Argentina, I think, Paraguay border, and where three countries come together. It's a magnificent, huge natural wonder. And you know, so I see a couple trips I could take. I'd love to get to Brazil. You know, there's Rio and the rainforest, the coast. So I can in Chile and Santiago. And so I think there's a lot of trips I could take to South America. And then I still have sort of Central Europe to do, the Croatia and Hungary and.
In Bulgaria, where I work.
In Bulgaria.
Yes, yes. Now, are you trying to set some kind of, like, record? I mean,
you may be the most world-traveled dialysis patient in the world.
That's what I'm saying. What is the book, Ripley's Believe It or Not? Ripley's.
And there you go. The Guinness.
Yeah, the Guinness.
It is kind of a Ripley's Believe It or Not, because I think some people listening may not, you know, believe that you've actually done this, but because you know, it's so hard to believe, but it's just absolutely amazing that I think you.
Well, I just think it's just worked out real well. I mean, it's a good fit for travel. I think, like, when I'm going around Europe with someone, a lot of times travel can seem like a three-legged race. You got to do everything together. But when people travel with me, they know they're going to have 5 hours, 3 days a week that they can do whatever they want. A lot of times they sleep, but anyways, if they, you know, so it's just, it works out great.
You always travel with somebody, right?
No, I've always said that if the choice is between going alone and not going, I'll go alone. So
do you enjoy it more alone, or do you enjoy it more with somebody else?
You know, it just doesn't. I have great times when I travel by myself, and then people a lot of times will plug into parts of it, but don't have a preference. I'm happy to go alone.
You know, let me ask you something. Now, this is just between you and me and Lori, and probably about 200 million other people.
That's right.
Have you ever been on a trip with someone that you wish you hadn't gone on it with them? You don't have to mention names. We don't want names or anything. We just want to know. Have you ever?
The first trip I took in '96, I was in Paris. I had started by myself for 3 weeks. Then I went to Paris, met my mom, and traveled with my mom for 2 weeks.
I hope it's not your mom you're going to say you weren't. You didn't want to be.
No, well, what happened was after the 2 weeks we traveled together, we came back to Paris, and I had a girlfriend come. And so it was hard to have both a girlfriend and a mom at the same time. So one or the other, I would say, on that. But, yeah, so that was the lesson.
Yeah, that would be difficult. Yeah. Well, and now how do you choose where you're going to go? Do you take a globe and throw a dart at it, and then that's wherever it lands, that's where you go?
Well, yeah, it's opportunity, and, you know, just with Europe, it was just like keep going back for a second. You know, so I had done the trip in 96 with 2 months and hit 7 different countries, and then 97 went back and went from Portugal to Italy, and then 98 was a cruise, and in 2000, and I went to Turkey, and so I just, you know, love traveling around Europe, keep going back to Paris. And
how do you get all this time off?
Well, it's a priority. And so I work through the union, and I'm not on the clock. I'm not getting paid, so I can take unpaid time off. But that, it, you know, travel is a priority, it has been, and so it's not promised. Like, maybe they'll change the union rules. So I wanted to make sure I got in a travel, and now here it is 11 years later. I'm still going, but I just
now
take
the next trip.
You mentioned
your dog earlier. Do you take your dog along?
No, my dog's real lucky that he comes to work with me every day. And when I travel, he actually comes to work anyways. Usually a friend will drop him off, or else my person who rents my mother-in-law.
For you? Is that what you're saying?
What was that?
Does someone do your job for you while you're gone?
He has more hours here than I do, because he's always here, but it's a good deal. So he comes in here. He just thinks he works here, and we
and
happen
you're in
to
the
carpool.
Carpenters Union, right? You're in the Carpenters Union?
That's right. And so he's the union steward. He's the shop steward here.
Yeah, so it must be really weird to see a pug with a tool belt on.
A pug?
I know, Bill, you have a blog, correct, for those of the people who don't know what
a
blog is.
Yeah, when I travel, I love to write and read and things I don't have time to do when I'm at home. So lately I've been putting it onto that globaldialysis.com website. And so there, for instance, I would send in reports from my 3 weeks in Mexico, which I just had last Christmas. Went down and started the trip by myself, went to Chichen Itza, which was a Mayan ruin, and then Merida, the capital of the Yucatan, and then took a bus back across the Yucatan Peninsula, 5-hour bus ride, and spent the next week in Cancun by myself taking Spanish lessons. And then right before Christmas, my family came down, and I spent time with them, and then I had a couple days by myself, and then a friend I've known since we were 8 years old, came down with his son, and we spent about 5 days over New Year's together. So, you know, that's all written up on the blog. And then I went back and posted previous trips, and I'll keep trying to post things as I find it.
Well, that's really interesting. So if people want to, you know, ask you a question or confer with you, they can go to this blog that you have.
Yeah, or there's actual discussion boards, too, where there's a travel category, and people post questions all the time about, you know, recommending a dialysis unit in New York, or how to set up dialysis in Rome, those sort of things. What's a good unit in London? And those are all questions I've answered, and I love answering questions on there, because then they're there for other people. Because I would say almost always, if you have a question, someone else has the same question. So try to answer those. And it's not just me, though. There's the whole community of people who are traveling
right,
able to answer your questions.
Right. And so it's, what is it again? What's the name of the website again?
It's globaldialysis, all one word, .com.
Globaldialysis.com, and you can go to your blog.
And
that's right.
You know, Bill, will you come back on our show sometime and maybe compile the top 10 questions people have about travel?
Sure.
And answer them for us? I think that would be fun.
That would be great.
But you got to do it in a David Letterman style.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Top
right.
10.
Thank you so much for joining us. And,
oh, thank you.
You're probably off to the airport right now as we speak.
That's
exactly.
Right, packing my bags. So.
All righty.
Okay, thank you,
thanks,
Bill.
Sorry.
Bye.
Good talking to you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Traveling man, yes, I'm a traveling man.
More than 20 million Americans, one in nine adults, have chronic kidney disease, and another 20 million more are at risk. Yet most people don't even know it. Anyone can get chronic kidney disease, but some people are more likely than others to develop it. People in high-risk groups include diabetics and those with high blood pressure. Chronic kidney disease usually causes no symptoms until it reaches an advanced stage, but simple tests can be done to detect kidney disease early. Please visit your doctor to find out if you might be at risk, and if you've been diagnosed with kidney disease, have your family members tested.
Wow, that was a really fascinating show. I just want to be taken away.
No, the bath.
That's the bath.
That's Calgon.
I guess I need a
travel agent to take a bath, Lori.
Just take me away. Okay,
she's very
so I need
spoiled.
To come up
she
with
that. She has to have somebody book her bath for her.
I know. Well, I think the one thing that's so refreshing about this whole show is it just reminds everybody that you can still do the things you want to. Sometimes you have to just plan a little bit more. But you can still live a full life and still travel.
And I think Bill Peckham really, you know, showed us how, you know, you can do it and doesn't let anything stop you at all.
And I think what's really interesting about his story is that he enjoys traveling more because he makes it part of the adventure. You know, it's like he's going to go to this new unit and he meets all these new people. And he makes it part of the experience of traveling. And that's what traveling is really about, is about experiencing new things and adventure.
I know.
What can be more adventurous than going to a dialysis unit out of the country?
Right, exactly. I mean, and the thing is, when I travel, I like to do some of the touristy things, but one of my favorite things is to do what the locals do.
Exactly.
And like you said, what's more local than going to a dialysis unit?
Exactly, learning about the culture. And then just learning the little nuances about what you need to do to travel safely and make sure that you're totally prepared. Because,
right,
you know,
it takes some preparation more so than saying, hey, let's just go to, you know, Africa this weekend or something.
To ensure that your travel experience is good.
Right.
And I think that that's really important. So we really appreciate all that information that we received.
Yeah, so happy traveling, people. And if you have a suggestion about traveling and something that you've experienced as a patient traveling, give us a call.
Our number is 866-379-4673.
And you have to dial the one now.
Yes.
Say it again.
1-866-379-4673. And leave a message for us and we'll possibly play it on the air in the future.
And if we play it on the air, what do you win?
You win. I know you want the can of kidney beans. I know I can send you a complimentary renal support network.
Two free replica tickets to Tanzania. They're not real tickets. They're replicas.
Exactly. And you can also send us an email at kidneytalk@rsnhope.org.
Happy traveling.
Renal Support Network would like to thank everyone who has made this show possible.
Kidney Talk's founding sponsor is Amgen.
Generous support is provided by Roche Pharmaceuticals and Astellas.
Friends of Kidney Talk are Abbott Laboratories, American Regent, and Fresenius Medical Care North America.
Thank you for helping us stream health, happiness, and hope to the kidney community.
Visit rsnhope.org for more information.
We can control our own destiny.
We can take charge of our health and ask questions about our medical options.
We can form partnerships with our healthcare team.
We can take steps towards self-improvement.
We can be sensitive to the impact of our disease on our family.
We can sing, dance, laugh, and enjoy our lives.
We can appreciate today and look forward to tomorrow.
We can help and support our fellow patients.
We can pursue our hopes and dreams.
We can make a difference.